Last week we didn't hear the announcements either, so I want to make one big announcement from last week. I think everybody's heard this already, but Scott Blake is now the principal at Central City Elementary School. And I'm just proud of him and all that he's done to get to this point in his life, so you pray for him. Speaking of prayer, I need you to continue to pray for Cadence Stone and her mom, Leslie. Both are still in the hospital recovering from a kidney transplant surgery. It's going to be a long and hard recovery, so we need you to pray earnestly for them. Leslie, I'll say especially right now, keep her in your prayers. We want to pray for Jim Yates. Things are going on with his blood pressure and like that, but we want you to pray for him. I'm going to ask you to pray for David, my son. He's also in need of prayer. Secondly, I want to make sure you tune into our YouTube and Facebook page as we put daily things out there. Scott has his children's sermon out there ready for you. And every Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, we put a midweek Bible study out there. So please go out there, share that so that others will be able to see it. The last thing is, we have a special called business meeting next week after the service. I'll give you the things so you can pray about them. Nominating committee is making a motion to elect Earl Rager to be on the personnel committee. They also are making a motion to appoint Ricky Ferguson to the cemetery committee. The personnel committee makes a motion to pay Tyler Harris a salary of $50 per week to operate the sound system. And the last thing is, from the personnel committee, makes a motion to discontinue salaries of the youth and children's directors, activities building, music, pianist, and church secretary until further notice. So you pray about those things, and we'll vote on them next week. Today's message is entitled, How Great Thou Art. And that's the song I want us to meditate on as we begin our service. How great thou art. You can sing along.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
has become one of the greatest and most popular hymns of Christendom. It's not one of the oldest. You'd be surprised. This song was written by a Christian in Sweden back in 1949 and set to music. I mean, there's a bunch of you that are older than that, right, Shorty? This is not a very, very old song. It was written right after a thunderstorm. This man of God was sitting out on the porch and watching this terrible storm come through, and it subsided kind of quickly, and the birds began to sing, and his story goes that he just fell to his knees in humble adoration of God and penned the words to that song. And it's become one of the great hymns of the faith, rivaled only by probably Amazing Grace. Well, God is indeed great. He's all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving. God is all-present. The basic premise of our message today is to remind you how great our God is and to tell you that with God, nothing is impossible. Sometimes it seems like we face impossible circumstances. It seems like the odds are against us and that we just have no hope. It just seems we can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. And it's easy to get discouraged. But I'm here to remind you this morning that God is the God of the impossible. There is nothing that God cannot do. So how do you handle life's impossible situations? There's one way. Only one way. Go to a great and mighty God. Sometimes our lives get into tangles. Well, I've got some extension cords at home that get tangled up something fierce. You get tangles in your hair. You ever have a childhood wish come true? I heard about a guy who said that when he was growing up, getting ready for school, his mama would brush the tangles out of his hair, and the whole time he's sitting there wishing, I just wish I had no hair. And guess what? When he grew up, he had no hair. He's now bald. Sometimes our wishes come true. Well, that was a joke, so never mind. Let me just share a few verses that talk about the greatness of our God. Our text is 1 Samuel 17, so you can turn there, but this is out of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 32:7 says, "Ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you." The prophet came to a point in his life where he just looked at all that God had done, and he said, "There is nothing too hard for you." When what you and I call impossible is really nothing to God. It's just like this. By the way, tax is coming up. You got it. That second deadline is coming up. You need to get it done. But a tax form to me is impossible. But a CPA like my daughter Rachel, it's nothing to her. Easy peasy. Car problems, impossible for me. But I take it to a mechanic and it's nothing for them. Tying your shoe, nothing for me, but for a 4-year-old, a 5-year-old, it's impossible to tie a tie. No, my tie's not tied real well. It was earlier, but it got too hot to leave it tied up. But it's impossible for some of you. To me, easy. I can do it blindfolded. Well, just down a couple of verses from the verse I read in Jeremiah 32, now we're in verse 27, it's like God responds to Jeremiah's statement of faith. He says, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh." And he asks this question, "Is there anything too hard for me?" God is asking you to substitute your impossibilities for that word anything in that verse. God is saying, fill in the blank. Is anything too hard for me? Beloved, the answer is, of course not. He is God, the creator, the sustainer of the universe. Even in the New Testament, in Luke chapter 1, verse 37, the angel said, "For with God nothing will be impossible." He's talking to Mary after Mary asked him, "How can I be pregnant and still be a virgin?" For God, nothing is impossible. Jesus was speaking to the rich young ruler, and he tells him, "The things which are impossible with men are possible with God." So I want you to think about something that seems impossible to you right now. Maybe it's your neighbor, Earl, that you've been witnessing to for years and years and years. And we have a loved one who is unsaved, and we've talked to them, but it just seems impossible. Maybe it's a health problem. Maybe it's an issue with your family. Maybe it's a job situation, a behavior problem, a sin problem, a habit that you have, and you say, it's just impossible. This problem may seem impossible for us to handle, and maybe it is, but God is the God of the impossible. Does this mean that God is going to make all of your problems disappear? Absolutely not. It's not going to happen. But what it does mean is that there's no problem that is too big that God isn't able to see you through it. He may not take it away. He has the power to. But for some reason, he may choose just to help you go through that problem. He will help you overpower that situation. So I want to use a very familiar story in the Bible to show you the greatness of God and to teach you again how God is the God of the impossible. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, we read the story of David and Goliath. Now, before we get to 17, in chapter 14, Israel has a battle against the Philistines, and they defeat them handedly. Now, we have to have that in the back of our mind, because when we come to chapter 17, this is when they are arrayed in battle, one on one side, one on the other. The children of Israel won that first battle, but now the Philistines return, and they have a secret weapon. His name is Goliath. And what the Philistines are wanting to do is try to psych out Saul's army. See, they couldn't win the physical war, so they're waging a mental war. And Goliath, this giant, he is challenging the men of Saul to send out the best of the best, to fight the giant one-on-one. Now, that's what Satan wants to do with all of us. He wants to isolate you from the herd, just the way a lion does its prey. Try to get one off to themselves. Beloved, you have to understand, you are in a battle every day. The Apostle Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 6, beginning at verse 11, he says to put on the whole armor of God. Why do you need to put on armor unless you're in a battle every day of your life? Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. And again, he tells us, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. See, you can go up against the enemy one-on-one, but guess what? You'll lose. Satan is no match for God, though. When you have him on your side, when you get behind God and let God handle the battle, you're going to win. Goliath, he's standing there and he's messing with the minds of the people of God. In verse 8, if you have your Bible open, it says, and he stood and he cried unto the armies of Israel and said to them, why are you come out, set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine, and you the servants of Saul? Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. In other words, he's saying, you're all dressed up for battle. Why don't you send one down, and we'll take care of this one-on-one. Any one of the soldiers in Saul's camp would have looked like Barney Fife tackling somebody like Andre the Giant. Remember that big wrestler guy? It all boils down to a battle for your mind. That's what the battle, that's where the battle is being fought today. See, in a lot of sporting events, you'll find the opponent trying to psych out the other team. They're trying to get into their head. It happens with fighters. It happens with baseball. You know, the catcher's down there, and he's just getting into the head of the batter. They're trying to psych out the other guy, the other team. If you ever watch a football game, you look at these linemen that come out. Boy, they're huge guys. These guys are monsters. And if I were the quarterback, I'd quit right there. As soon as they came out onto the field, I'd be gone. I couldn't see them coming after me. Intimidation is the weapon. Intimidation is the same weapon that Satan uses against the child of God all the time. He'll say things like, you can't do that. He'll say, that's impossible. And sadly, we believe them too often. The sad thing is, we quit. Satan fights his battle in our thought life, in our mind. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5 says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Listen to what he says. Verse 5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Beloved, there are some nights until I read that verse, until I meditate on that verse, I can't sleep. Thoughts going through my mind. But I bring it into obedience to Christ, and I begin to dwell upon the Word of God, and I go right to sleep. When we let Satan control our thought life, we open ourselves to defeat. Because Satan will appeal to the unrighteous desires of your heart. And we open ourselves up to defeat because we leave God out of our thought life. God is the only one who can defeat the devil. He is our strength. He is our victory. He is our source of power. Don't ever try to fight the enemy one-on-one. He'll win every time. If I were that quarterback and those linemen come on the field and they're pointing at me and says, I'm coming to get you, boy, I'd tremble in my cleats. Until I realize I have some linemen of my own. I have a defense against those big guys on the other team. Satan uses the strategy, divide and conquer. And when he isolates you from the power and the greatness of God, he has already won the battle. He uses discouragement to isolate you from God's people. He will get you to quit coming to church. He'll get you to quit coming to Sunday school. Of course, we're not having it right now, but when we do, you're going to try to make an excuse not to be here. And then, when he has you all alone, he'll flood your thoughts with doubts and fears and lies and deceit to keep you from serving God. You remember what God's word said about the devil? He said he has wiles. That means that he's a wily coyote. He has some tricks up his sleeves that we can't handle on our own. We need the Spirit of God in our life, meditating upon him to overcome the enemy. You and I are no match for Satan. Just look at Goliath. Goliath was a type of Satan. If you have your Bible open, chapter 17, 1 Samuel, verse 4 says that this giant was 9 foot 9 inches tall. That's almost 3 foot taller than any of the NBA players. His armor weighed 125 pounds. Verse 7 says the tip of his spear weighed 15 pounds. That's the size of a bowling ball. We can't even roll the bowling ball down the alley, much less throw it across the field of battle. Goliath continues his challenge in verse 10. He says, the Philistine says, I defy the army of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. And verse 11 tells us, when Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. That word dismayed means they were flat out on the ground in fear. They faced an impossible battle, just like you do every day, and they were in fear. They had their focus on the giant. When you get your focus on the problem, you're headed for defeat. Now comes little David. He volunteers to fight the giant. Verse 32, David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him, talking about Goliath. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. Now, why would this little shepherd boy volunteer to fight against the giant? Simple, because David knew the greatness and the power of God. He'd seen it before. In verses 34 through 36, David gives a testimony of the greatness of God. David said to Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him, and I smote him, and I delivered the little lamb out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard, and I smote him, and I slew him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing that he has defiled the armies of the living God. David had a testimony. David has seen the power of God. You've seen the power of God, the greatness of God in your life. You've seen God do great and mighty things in your life and around you. So David volunteers to go out. He volunteers to go and do the impossible, face the impossible opponent. Before he goes, Saul calls him into his tent. He says, here, put on my armor. David said, this is not the protection that I need. And he didn't say that because it was built for the biggest guy in all of Israel, and here was David, just a kid. He said that because it wasn't the protection that he needed, because God was all that he needed. Beloved, whatever battle you are facing, whatever you're going through, there's only one thing you need, and that is God. David knew that he could not defeat that giant one-on-one. He knew that he was no match for the giant. And by using Saul's armor, that was not going to help. And we need to get this into our minds. When we begin to see that we cannot fight one-on-one, that is when we begin to get the victory over the Goliaths of our life. Once we see that we cannot defeat the enemy on our own, and that no matter what things of the world that we try to fashion into protection, it will not work. It's only then that we learn to rely upon the Lord and see that he will give you the victory. Goliath came out every morning, every night for 40 days, and he challenged the army of Saul. He taunted them. Goliath dared them. He slandered their names, slandered the name of their God, and all of the soldiers looked at that giant. There was no takers. They're shaking in their sandals because they were no match for the giant. But David could come out to meet the giant in verse 40, taking only a sling and five smooth stones. You know, that must have really irritated that giant. Here was a man of war. He had been raised to fight in battles. And he sees little David coming out and he starts mocking him. Because all Goliath could see was a shepherd boy who had no armor, no protection, only a slingshot and a bag of stones. But what Goliath couldn't see was David's God. One of the greatest statements of faith in all the Word of God is found in verse 45 of 1 Samuel 17. When David said to the Philistine, "Thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied." Goliath saw a young shepherd boy, but what he missed was seeing the power and the greatness of God. He's going to see it in just a minute. Without Christ, listen, we stand before Satan helpless, weak. Poor shepherd boys. We are as helpless as a quarterback without an offensive line. When we try to fight our spiritual battles under our own power, we're going to fail. But when we fight our spiritual battles in God's power, there is nothing too hard for him. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13 says, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." We can say, like David did in verse 46 and 47, the battle is the Lord's. Why do we try to do the impossible? On our own. Why do we ignore God when confronted with the Goliaths of our life? Why do we fail to pray, to believe God, to trust God when God is the God of the impossible? Just doesn't make sense, does it? Our problem is we are not expecting God to do great things in our life. So as we look at the story, who defeated Goliath? Did David? Is he the hero? No. David's not the hero of the story. David was only an instrument that God used to do the impossible. I've seen God do the impossible, haven't you? All week long I've been praying for Leslie, for Cadence, and I was getting the hourly reports from Chad. He kept texting me about how great things were and what was going on. And it just reminded me that God is the God of the impossible. God tells us that he just wants to use us, our prayers, our faith in him, to do the impossible. He just wants to work in us and through us to do the impossible. So when David let that rock fly by faith in God, that giant went down like a sack of potatoes. And in verse 51, it tells us the rest of the enemy fled. They ran away. You want to see Satan flee from your life? You want to be rid of all that he is throwing at you? I've got the secret. It's found in James chapter 4, verse 7. And it begins by saying, therefore, submit to God. Submit to God. That's the secret. Because it goes on to say, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Now, what would have happened to David if he did not submit to God? If he tried to go out against that giant as a little shepherd boy, that's all it would have been. It would have been a little shepherd boy against a great big giant. And you've probably felt that way from time to time, that you are in battle with the devil one-on-one. Well, the good news this morning is that you don't have to feel that way. 1 John 4:4 says, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So if you have any Goliaths in your life, you know some giant that is overwhelming you, you have some impossible situation, you have something that you're afraid of, you don't have to face it alone. If you do, Satan will just laugh at you. But submit to God. Turn it over to him. Let him take care of it. Do what he has called you to do. Repent if that needs to be repentance. Make some changes in your life, but submit to God. Let him do the fighting for you, and the enemy will flee. You've been trusting in yourself far too long. You've been leaving God out of your life far too long. And that's why your life is just one defeat after another. Your life is like a roller coaster, up one minute, down the next. I'm here to tell you again this morning, my God is the God of the impossible. There's nothing my God cannot do. He may not see you around every battle, but he's going to see you through every battle, every trial, every temptation, every burden, every circumstance of life. Because he is the God of the impossible. Did you know that he can save your soul right now? If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, he can save you. With you, it's impossible. You can't save yourself. But Jesus came to fight the battle for your soul, and he won. And we have the cross, and we have the empty tomb to prove it. Just repent. Turn to God for salvation. There's no one he cannot. There's no one that he will not save. And Christian friend, there is nothing my God cannot do. There's nothing my God won't do for you. Let's pray. We'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would help us to always live in the victory because we have submitted to you. We have followed you. Help us to see, Lord God, that the battle is yours. The circumstances we're going through in our life, the problems that we're facing, the giants that are in our life, they are there, but you are greater than all of them. And God, we have nothing in our own resources, in the resources of this world, to come against them except the name of the Lord. And so we rebuke the powers of darkness. I pray that you'd build a hedge of protection around each and every one that is here today. I plead the blood of Jesus upon them to keep them safe and to keep them from being overwhelmed. I pray that they would not allow themselves to be isolated and just allow their minds to run with all of the false and evil things that are being said to them. But God, that they would look to you for truth. They would look to you for guidance. They would look to you for victory. And we do pray it all in the name of Jesus, the God of the impossible. Amen. One last song, and we're dismissed. God bless you. Again, thank you all for being here. This is amazing, amazing, amazing. God bless you.